Namaste. In this video, we shall look at the Mundaka Upanishad. The term Mundaka means shaved or shorn, and a shaved head symbolizes sannyasa or complete renunciation. You must have seen that people who have taken up sannyasa, monks, they shave their head. So, sannyasa or complete renunciation, that is what it signifies. The Mundaka Upanishad is meant for those who have developed detachment towards the ephemeral pleasures of the world and are seeking the permanent truth. One who reads the Mundaka Upanishad would get the idea that the overall theme of the Upanishad, the overall drive, what it tries to drive home, is an emphasis on sannyasa or renunciation. It says that it's only through renunciation that one attains the highest knowledge, which is called paravidya, which we will be coming to. The Mundaka Upanishad has three chapters, each of which is called a Mundaka. Just like each chapter in the Prashna Upanishad is called a Prashna, each chapter in the Mundaka Upanishad is called a Mundaka. And each of these Mundakas is further divided into two sub-chapters, which is called a Khanda. Khanda, as we all know, means a part or a division. So there are three Mundakas, and each Mundaka has two Khandas. So totally six Khandas. India's national motto, which we find written below the national emblem, the Ashoka lines, Satyameva Jayate, is taken from a shloka which we find in this Upanishad. The shloka goes Satyameva Jayate Nanritam, and it is found in the third Mundaka, first Khanda, the sixth shloka. This Upanishad is in the form of the teaching imparted by Angiras, the guru, to Shaunaka, who is the disciple. Again, this is one of those Upanishads which are in the form of a conversation between a guru and a Shishya. Shaunaka, who is a householder, approaches Angiras and asks him the famous question, a very popular question, Kasminnu Bhagavo Vignyate Sarvamidam Vignyatam Bhavati. What does it mean? What is it by knowing which everything becomes known? That is the question asked by Shaunaka. The answer given by Angiras forms the remainder of the Upanishad, and we'll be seeing that. Now, the first topic under Mundaka Upanishad, and probably the most popular topic connected with the Mundaka Upanishad, is the doctrine of Para and Aparavidya, the two approaches or divisions in knowledge, two approaches to Brahman, Para and Aparavidya. So, to continue from the previous slide, when Shaunaka asks this question to Angiras, who is the guru, Angiras replies by saying that there are two kinds of knowledge. What are they? Paravidya and Aparavidya. Para refers to superior knowledge and Apara refers to inferior knowledge. And Angiras first defines what Aparavidya is, and it's a very interesting definition. He says Aparavidya is the knowledge contained in all the Vedas. And Vedas here includes the Upanishads also, Vedas plus Upanishads. And the Vedangas. What are the Vedangas? The Vedangas are six in number. They are Shiksha, which is the science of pronunciation, Vyakrana, which is the science of the grammar, Sanskrit grammar, Chandas, which refers to the poetic meter, the meter in which the poetry is composed, Nirukta, which is etymology, Jyotisha, which is astrology, as we all know, and Kalpa, which refers to the science of particularities, how to arrange a yajna, for example, what should be done when and all that, the particularities of the yajna come under Kalpa. So these are the Vedangas. The Vedangas are meant to help one to properly understand the Vedas. They are considered to be limbs of the Vedas. They help one to properly understand the Vedas. Angiras says all these come under Aparavidya or inferior knowledge. Now, the Vedas, as we have seen, are the highest texts of knowledge in Vedic religion. All the Shatdarshanas accept the what is contained in the Vedas to be the ultimate truth. So when he says that these texts themselves are inferior knowledge, what does it mean? And what is it that is superior than this? What is it that is called Paravidya? Paravidya is that by which the imperishable is attained. Paravidya is the actual Brahmajnana. Adi Shankara, in his commentary to the Mundaka Upanishad, explains this division by saying that the actual knowledge that is contained in the Vedas, the words and the sentences themselves, are inferior knowledge because just by them remaining in the book, nobody is going to benefit from it and nobody is going to get liberated. Nothing is going to happen. And even if one manages to simply memorize the verses and recite them without properly understanding their import, nothing is going to happen. So as they are inferior knowledge, aparavidya. But when one realizes them, one sees them as reality, one internalizes that and makes it his own knowledge, that is when it becomes paravidya. So that is the difference between Paravidya and Aparavidya. Paravidya is that by which the imperishable, Aksharam, is attained, which refers to Brahmajnana, the realization of truth. Paravidya is to realize the knowledge of Brahman, which is the source of the cosmos. It is through this knowledge that one knows everything. Now he connects it to Shaunaka's original question. What was his question? What is it by knowing which everything can be known? How is it? I mean, what is that one thing? If I know this one thing, I can know everything else. That is the question. How to make sense of this question? Let's take the example of ornaments. Let's take the example. Let's think of ornaments which are made of gold. Let's say that there is a bracelet, there is a necklace, and there is a ring made of gold, all made of gold. Now, based on their form, each one is different from the other. The bracelet is not the ring is not the necklace. They are completely different when it comes to their form. They don't look alike. They don't serve similar function also. One can only wear a ring in his finger. He can't wear it in his neck. So they are completely different when it comes to the form. But when one looks at them as gold, they are one. They are not different from one another. And when one understands what gold is, what is it that gold is, when he understands the reality as gold, it can be said that he understands what these three things are, even if he might not know, what form they are in and what function they serve. Form and function are secondary, and the material is the primary thing. Without a material, without gold, there can be no form or function, right? So, similarly, when he talks about that by knowing which everything can be known, what Shaunaka is referring to is what is that the origin of everything? What is the origin? What is the source from which the entire creation has come about? So that I may know, by knowing that, I can know everything else. And the answer to that given by Angiras is that it is Brahman. It is the imperishable Brahman, and it is only by knowing Brahman, because Brahman is the origin of the cosmos, that one can know everything else. One can know the reality behind everything else. So that is Angiras's reply. So that covers the first topic, which is Para and Aparavitya. And this is the most popular topic, most common topic associated with Mundaka Upanishad. If you see Para and Aparavidya, your mind has to go to Mundaka Upanishad. It is, it's found exclusively in the Mundaka Upanishad. The next topic is the greatness of Brahma Vidya. Paravidya, which is the knowledge of Brahman or the self, is called the bridge leading to immortality. So he says that Brahma Vidya, Paravidya is of Brahma Vidya, Paravidya, knowledge of the self, they all mean the same thing. So it is said that when one has it, it becomes the bridge leading to immortality. One becomes immortal by knowing this. That is the greatness of Brahma Vidya. There are various shlokas which deal with the greatness of Brahma Vidya throughout the Upanishad. I've just picked them up from different places and I've presented it here. There is another shloka which directly deals with the result of Brahma Vidya. And what does it say? It's a beautiful shloka. One must read it to actually appreciate the beauty of it in Sanskrit. The English version does not do any justice to it. When the self is realized, the knot of the heart gets untied. All doubts get resolved and all past karma gets destroyed. What is the knot of the heart? The commentator again, Adi Shankara, helps us out here. He says the knot of the heart refers to all our desires and tendencies, which are, our emotions, our feelings, all of that. He says all that goes away. All our desires are satisfied. They go away, they do not come back again. That is the knot of the heart getting untied. All doubts get resolved. There is no more samshaya. And all past karma gets destroyed. By past karma here is referred to the there are three kinds of karma, agami, sanchita karma. So those two get destroyed. The prarabdha karma would still remain. The karma which has produced this present body and life, that would still continue. Which is why there are certain self-realized people who would still be leading a life even after getting self-realization. Like Ramana Maharishi, for example, or Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, Vivekananda. So they are called Jivan Muktas. So their prarabdha karma will continue. That cannot be destroyed. So that will go on, and when prarabdha karma gets over, then they get videham. So when they say all past karma gets destroyed, it is the stock, original stock of karma, the agami karma and the sanchita karma, that gets destroyed. Which means that there is no more births after that. When after this life is done, there is no more births. There is one gets complete liberation. In another shloka, we find the knowledge of Brahman, the knower of Brahman is said to transcend the human seed, meaning that he is not born again. Again, this same point. Shloka from the third Mundaka, second Khanda, fifth shloka, describes the knowers of Brahman as follows. They become contented with their knowledge, established in the self, freed from attachment and composed. contemplating on it, it refers to Brahman, contemplating on it constantly, they enter into it. This again, you know, entering into it, we will be seeing it later in another shloka. I'll talk about it more at that time. So this is what we find in another shloka. We find the glory of Brahma Vidya in shloka from the third mundaka, second khanda, ninth shloka. The knower of Brahman becomes Brahman. This is a very popular statement used by Advaita Vedantins, that the knower of Brahman becomes Brahman. In his line, there is not born anyone who does not know Brahman. This is meant to glorify Brahma Vidya, to say that, you know, all his descendants would be enlightened people. He overcomes grief and papa punya, both papa and punya. We must understand that in Vedanta, when we read the Upanishads, in the philosophy of the Upanishads, both papa and punya are considered to be bondages. Swami Vivekananda beautifully says in one of his poems, he says that you know, punya or merits, they are like a golden chain. Papa or demerits, they are like an iron chain. Ultimately, both are chains. Both bind the man. So, both papa and punya have to be overcome. So, it says that the knower of Brahman overcomes grief and both papa and punya. He becomes freed from the knots of the heart, again, the same point, and attains immortality. So, this is what the Mundaka Upanishad talks about, the greatness of Brahma Vidya. The next topic is about the worthlessness of selfish karma. The second khanda of the first mundaka discusses the effects of doing yajnas and rituals with a selfish motive. Almost the entire khanda, there are multiple shlokas which are devoted to describing the proper way in which a karma has to be done by a person who is desirous of getting the result. It describes, you know, the method of it, how to do it, when the oblation should be poured, everything is described. But that is not meant to encourage one to do a karma that way. The conclusion is more important. Upanishad says that those who follow the injunctions of Karmakanda properly will enjoy pleasures in heaven. It makes that clear, that if you do good actions with a more, you know, selfish motive, you will enjoy the fruits of it. You might go to the highest of heavens and you will enjoy there. There is no doubt about that. And the Upanishad says that these people, when they have attained such a state, when they have attained a great a world where there is much greater pleasure, they think that they are wise and learned and that they have attained the goal of life. Now the Upanishad says, however, these people are deluded fools. The word that the Upanishad uses is pramudhaha, great fools. Since the result of selfish karma is not permanent and they will be born again on earth. It beautifully says that even if he goes to the highest peak of the heaven, nakasya prishthe, even if he goes to the peak of the highest heaven, he will still have to come back and be born again on earth. Because the idea is that any result which is generated by doing a finite action cannot be infinite. It is not that one can do a finite good action on earth here and enjoy infinite time in any heaven. The time might be a million years. It could be a billion years. But ultimately, there will come a time when it will get over. It cannot go on forever. He will have to come back to earth again and be born. It even says that some people are even born in subhuman species. So the idea is that, why is selfish karma worthless? Because it does not produce any permanent result. It does not give any permanent solution. So that is the idea. The next topic is about tapas and guru bhakti. Tapas and guru bhakti are extolled as important virtues which lead to self-realization. After denouncing the performance of kamya karma, as we saw in the previous section, which are, kamya karma means actions that are done out of desire. Kamya means out of desire. The Upanishad praises those who resort to tapas, austerity, shraddha, which is faith, and have their senses under control. A man who has realized the futility of kamya karma and has consequently renounced it should approach a guru who is well versed in the Vedas and established in Brahman. I've kept those two phrases in bold because being well versed in the Vedas and being established in Brahman are considered to be the trademark of a guru. That which makes a person a guru are these two qualities. Shrotriyam Brahmanishtam. Those are the two terms that the Upanishad uses. He has to know the knowledge that the Vedas and the Upanishad contains, and he has to be established in Brahman, meaning that he must have realized that knowledge. He must have already seen the truth. So that is what a guru has to possess. So it says that those who have realized that, you know, by doing kamya karma, I can attain heaven, but that is not a permanent solution. So they should approach a guru who is well versed in the Vedas and established in Brahman and surrender to him. It is by the grace of the Guru that one attains paravidya, that is knowledge of Brahman, which leads to liberation. Therefore, Guru Bhakti is indispensable for attaining moksha. That is the greatness of Guru Bhakti that the Mundaka Upanishad speaks of. Tapas is also described as the cause of creation. It is said that because of tapas, Brahman is said to manifest the universe. This point we'll again be covering in another section as we move forward. So this is about tapas and Guru Bhakti. The next topic is about the origin of creation. The Mundaka Upanishad says that Brahman is the origin of creation. It says it in multiple places. There are three analogies given in Shloka 1.1.7, that is first Mundaka, first Khanda, seventh Shloka. There are three analogies given in the same Shloka. It says that the universe emerges out of Brahman. The first analogy is just as a spider builds its web using its own saliva. Just as the spider's web comes from a spider. I'll explain what it means. The second analogy is just as plants sprout from the earth. Third analogy, just as hair grows on the human body. Now, these three analogies serve a very specific purpose. They are there for a very, they present a particular argument. What is the first analogy mean? Just as a spider builds its web from its own saliva. What it means is, a spider, when it builds its web, it is both the efficient cause of the web. I think there was a video in which I had mentioned that there are two main kinds of causes, efficient cause and material cause. To quickly recap it, a material cause is what makes a thing. For example, if there is a clay pot, the clay which makes up the pot is the material cause. The efficient cause, which is also called the intelligent cause, is the intelligent which shapes the clay into the pot. The clay by itself cannot become a pot. There needs to be a potter who knows how to transform the clay into a pot. So that is the intelligent cause or efficient cause. There are two main kinds of causes. Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta in particular, says that both the efficient cause and the material cause of the entire universe is Brahman. That is the claim made by Advaita Vedanta. Not all schools of Indian philosophy accept this. For example, the Nyaya Darshana, if you remember the video that I had made earlier, believes that God or Ishvara is only the efficient cause. He is not the material cause. There is the common saying that we say that, everything is God around us. The Nayayikas would not, accept that. For them, the universe is different from God. God only shapes the universe. He is only the efficient cause, not the material cause. But Advaita Vedanta says, God or Brahman is both material and efficient cause. So the first analogy is meant to drive home that point. Why? Because when a spider builds its web, the material is not different from the spider. It is its own saliva. It comes from itself. The material comes from the spider. The spider is also the efficient cause because it is the spider which, weaves that beautiful web. So it is to say that the universe, just like a spider's web, has Brahman as both the material cause and the efficient cause. So that is the first, that is what the first analogy is meant to drive home. Second analogy says, just as plants sprout from the earth. Now this is meant to say, this is meant to drive home the fact that, the effect does not have any existence apart from the cause. Just like if you separate the plants from earth, if you uproot a plant, it dies. It does not have any more life. So similarly, it is meant to convey the point that the universe, if you try to separate it from Brahman in our understanding, it has no existence. It owes its existence to Brahman, just like plants owe their existence to the earth and they cannot be separated. That is the second point. Third analogy says, just as hair grows on the human body. This is a very interesting point. It is meant to address one particular criticism. The usual criticism that the Advaita Vedanta, the doctrine of Advaita Vedanta, that the universe comes from Brahman, comes from God, is that how do you account for the fact that God and the universe have such contrasting characteristics? God is meant to be infinite. The universe we find is full of finite objects, all limited objects. God is meant to be full of intelligence, but in the universe we find the universe is jada, which is insentient. How do you say that something which has such contradictory characteristics could come from a cause? The cause and the effect must have similar characteristics, right? How can you say that the effect which has such different characteristics from the cause could have come from that? So that is the criticism that is usually placed against Advaita Vedanta when they say that the universe has come from Brahman. The question that is asked is, The universe clearly has such different characteristics. It is very different from Brahman. How can you then say that it came from Brahman? Now, this analogy, the third analogy, is meant to address this point. It says that just as hair grows on the human body, hair is dead. It does not have life in itself. The human body is sentient, however. Right? So, just like a dead object can, or nails, for example, instead of hair, we can think of nails. Nails are dead, you know, they are dead. One does not feel any pain on the nails. You can only feel pain around the nails where it is connected to the flesh. And one can clip the nails and throw away and one would not feel any pain. Right? So, just like nails or hair grows on the human body, these are dead parts. These do not have life of their own. And yet they come from, their cause is the living human body. Just like we see that in our experience, we see that an effect which is different from the cause can come out of the cause, which has different characteristics from the cause can come out of a cause. Just like the dead hair and the dead nails can come out of the living body. So the third analogy is meant to address that specific point, which says that it is illogical to say that the universe comes from Brahman. It says that no, that is not so. Even in our own experience, we see that there are cases where the effect has a very different characteristic compared to the cause. So this is a very profound verse which provides three arguments essentially to uphold the doctrine of Advaita Vedanta, that Brahman is both efficient cause and material cause. Upadana karanam and nimitta karanam. It is said that because of tapas, Brahman expands. There is a typo there. Brahman expands and creation comes about. Tapasa chiyate brahma. That is the verse that is used. It says that because of tapas, chiyate means expands. Brahman expands and the creation comes about. Tapas is said to be the driving force behind creation in one sense. There are various verses in the Upanishad which speak of Brahman as the origin of creation. The first khanda of the second Mundaka exclusively deals with the various things which emerge out of Brahman. If you read that portion, you'll see that it enumerates the different things which come. It says that Akasha comes from Brahman, the Panchamahabhutas, they all come from Brahman, the sense organs, the pranas, they all come from Brahman, animals, plants, everything. It just goes on listing out things which come out of Brahman to drive home the point that everything, entire universe, has Brahman as its source, as its origin. And it begins with the shloka, a beautiful shloka. Again, just as sparks fly off from the blazing fire, all these creatures emerge out of Brahman and go back to it. It says that when a bonfire is lit, for example, there would be sparks of fire, tiny sparks of fire, which fly away and maybe fall away from the bonfire. It might seem that they are different from the bonfire, but in essence, they are also fire. They are not different from the bonfire. Similarly, it says, in a similar way, the entire universe of different creatures, it comes out of Brahman. It might seem like they are different, but in essence, they are the same. The Upanishad clearly says that the sparks which fly away from the fire are not different from the fire. They are the same. They have fire as their own essence. So, using that analogy again, the creation of the universe is explained. The khanda concludes by declaring that Brahman is the source of and reality behind the universe, and therefore it is by knowing it that one knows everything. Again, the same point to address Shaunaka's question: how does one? What is it by knowing which everything can be known? It is by knowing Brahman, who is the source of everything and the reality behind everything, that one can know everything else. One can know about everything. Just like by knowing the reality as gold, one can know that. One can know the reality behind everything made out of gold. I may not know the exact dimensions of what a ring is, of a ring or a necklace or a bangle which is made of gold. But if I know that it is, if I know what gold is, I can safely say that these are made out of gold. I know the reality behind them. Similarly, a person who knows Brahman knows the reality behind the entire universe, because the entire universe has Brahman as its material cause. So that is about the origin of creation in Mundaka Upanishad. The next and final topic, and a very beautiful topic, is the ultimate aim of meditation, which is Brahmanubhuti. You won't be able to see that because I've been selfish enough to keep my face big there. The topic is the ultimate aim of meditation is Brahmanubhuti. What is Brahmanubhuti? Brahmanubhuti is the experience of Brahman. The second khanda of the second Mundaka presents the analogy of a bow and arrow to explain how meditation leads to Brahmanubhuti or the experience of Brahman. The knowledge, so this is how they compare, meditation and the archery essentially. The knowledge found in the Upanishads, which can be summarized to Om, is described as the bow. It says that this knowledge is the Mahastram, Upanishadam Mahastram, Dhanur Grihitva Upanishadam Mahastram. What does it mean? It says pick up the bow. What is the bow? The bow refers to the knowledge found in the Upanishads, which is the Om, the knowledge of Brahman. Pick up that bow. Place on it the arrow, which is the jiva, the individual soul, sharpened by meditation. So that is the arrow. The target is the imperishable Brahman. So the bow is the knowledge of the Upanishads. The arrow is ourself, the individual self, the mind which is sharpened by meditation. That is the arrow. And the target is Brahman, the imperishable Brahman. When a person draws back the string and lets go of the arrow with his mind absorbed in the thought of Brahman, he achieves the target, that is oneness with Brahman. So it's an analogy that they give, that when you have your mind set on the target, which is Brahman, when you meditate on Brahman and let go of the string, just like the arrow becomes one with the target, it gets stuck to the target and becomes one with it, the individual soul becomes one with Brahman. The individual soul which represents the arrow becomes one with Brahman, which represents the target. So that is the analogy. It's a beautiful analogy that is given in the Mundaka Upanishad, to say that the ultimate aim of meditation is to attain the experience, the oneness with Brahman, the experience of Brahman, which is also, to attain oneness with Brahman. So that is the final topic to be covered under Mundaka Upanishad. With that, we conclude this video. Thank you.